Now to political commentary, still steeped in intellect, but far less civil than Shields and Brooks. Jeffrey Brown has the story.
To help us extract meaning from these conventions, two of America's most eloquent commentators, William Buckley and Gore Vidal.
Hard to imagine now, a time before political pundits dominated cable and broadcast news programs. The documentary Best of Enemies pinpoints a key moment of change when two intellectual giants, William F. Buckley on the right, Gore Vidal on the left, attracted a huge national audience with intelligence and wit, but also put-downs and insults.
Now I'll say it a third time.
No, twice is enough.
Filmmakers Morgan Neville and Robert Gordon explored a series of debates the two held during the 1968 political conventions that, for a variety of reasons, would alter the future of political discourse on television. We spoke recently at the AFI Docs Festival in Washington.
You set this up as both a personal and a kind of national epic. Why do you think it rose to that level?
Gore Vidal and William Buckley represented the polar opposites of the left and the right at a time when America was kind of coming apart at the seams a little bit. This is 1968. There's rioting in the streets, and they're representing those poles there on national TV. But what I think makes it such a dramatic story for us is that it was deeply personal. I mean, it was under the veneer of politics, but I think they saw in the other person somebody who could detect their own insecurities and expose those to the world.
You follow 10 debates, right? It is like a heavyweight and heavyweight fight, right? And you even have, you know, round one, round two, debate one, two, three. What happened? What did you see happening over the course of the fight, so to speak?
It was an ever-growing attack. We saw in the raw footage within like 2 minutes of the first debate, these high-minded guys take the low road. It becomes very personal.
Right away.
How old are that?
Shut up, Bill. Protest example.
This big blow-up was inevitable, although it's like a slow fuse, and you don't get that now. You don't get that kind of time on TV now to have a slow burn like that. Now it's like, you know, we're back, and here's the fireworks.
Over the course of 10 debates, that slow burn morphed into a bitter rivalry that was broadcast to millions.
There were so many nuggets we found. And one of my favorite things was going through Gore's papers at Harvard and finding the papers he had on his lap with him during the debates, which included pages of scripted insults that he had
really?
With him. That he had
scripted insults.
Scripted insults.
But he came to play.
He was there. With a game plan, and that was the evidence right there.
Yeah, and then of course it does lead up to this culminating, most famous moment where he does get under Buckley's skin. He calls him a crypto Nazi. Mm-hmm. Buckley comes back at with him with a calling him a queer and right. threatens to punch him in the mouth.
Now listen, you
the
queer,
right of the assembly
stop calling me a crypto Nazi.
Let's stop
or
calling
I'll
names.
You in
let's
your goddamn face, and you'll stay plastered.
It was one of those defining moments in television. You know, of course, there's rioting in the streets and people are paying attention to that, but most of America is taking this in on television. I mean, the television audience that night was huge, and this is before YouTube, before people could go back and analyze it. You know, it happened and then it vanished.
Is you're making the case that television news or television political discourse was never the same. The two men were actually never the same, right?
Right?
They never
mm-hmm.
quite got over this.
I mean, it was something that I think they were regularly asked about for the rest of their lives. It was something that not only did they have this big blow up on television, they wrote long pieces in Esquire magazine the next year, redebating this. And then they sued each other over those pieces for 3 years.
Why do you think they couldn't let it go, personally?
I think Buckley was the one who couldn't let it go. I think Gore would have just bragged about it at dinner parties the rest of his life, and that would have been it. I think Buckley really felt like he had to answer to himself for something that had happened. For Buckley, it was trying to explain why he lost his cool when he was the king of not losing his cool.
So uncharacteristically lost his cool, because that's what it was. It was unlike any other moment in his career. And I think that by showing that he couldn't let it go, Gore realized that he could continue to enjoy that moment of victory by bringing it up at every opportunity he was given.
to the right.
The spark between the two heavyweights was a hit with television audiences and a boon for ABC, desperate to stand out from its competitors. Sensing a good thing, executives there decided that instead of covering the conventions in full, they could punctuate the coverage with Vidal and Buckley's political and sometimes personal commentary.
ABC couldn't afford to do gavel-to-gavel coverage at the conventions as networks had traditionally done. And so they came up with what they called unconventional convention coverage, which was a kind of a distillation of the convention's news with these commentary segments every night, these debates between Vidal and Buckley.
And, ridiculed by the other networks.
Yeah. And in the aftermath of this, even with the big blow-up between Vidal and Buckley and the ratings it got, no network ever did gavel-to-gavel coverage again. And so it really did establish a new template.
These guys brought a command of history, of language, of politics, all these things to bear on this conversation, and it produced this massive forest fire. It just wants the flash paper fire. It just wants the flame. It doesn't care about what's burning.
And you're saying we're still living with that today?
That's what we, turn on the TV and see.
The film Best of Enemies can be seen in theaters nationwide. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Jeffrey Brown.